Thank you very much for the invitation to talk about this subject. Yeah, this is my conflicts of interest. This is where I come from, Hillerød, Nordsjælland's hospital, just north of Copenhagen. This is how it looks. See, part of it is a very old hospital, and this is a new hospital that will be finished in 5 years, hopefully. It's computer-generated pictures. Should fever be treated in ICU patients with infection or sepsis? When you ask that question, you often get this question in response: why interfere with the natural response to infection? And to answer that, you have to speculate what are the potentially detrimental effects of fever or the potential benefits of fever control. So fever increases the metabolic demand to maintain the body temperature at a new elevated set point. It increases oxygen consumption and carbon dioxide production. And in severe sepsis, it has been speculated at least that the metabolic demands of fever may exceed the ability to compensate. So that is some of the arguments. I will go through some of the literature and try to answer some of the questions. Will ICU patients be with infection benefit from fever respect, meaning no interaction, or fever control with antipyretic medicine or with external internal cooling? Or even will induced hypothermia be a good idea? And I will talk a little bit about the CAS study in the end. So, fever in the ICU. Is fever associated with death in ICU patients with infection? And that question has been asked by this very efficient research group from Australia and New Zealand. They looked at a database of 129 ICUs in Australia and New Zealand. And they had almost 270,000 admissions, and they looked at the independent association of peak temperature in the first 24 hours after ICU admission and the in-hospital mortality according to the diagnosis of infection. And this is what they found in the group of infected patients. They found a clear signal that in low temperature there was an association to mortality, but they didn't see that at high temperatures. But in the non-infected patients, the signal was different. The high temperatures also was associated with mortality. So they concluded that in the infected ICU patients, fever was associated with a decreased risk of death. And they hypothesized that the febrile response may be protective in infectious illnesses, and that reducing temperature even may be harmful in these patients. So what about, so this was the overall group of infected ICU patients. How about sepsis? And this is a very new study published this year by a Swedish group, and they looked at fever in patients with severe sepsis and septic shock in the emergency department, but admitted to ICU within 24 hours. And they looked into the Swedish National Quality Register for Sepsis, 30 ICUs in Sweden, and a little bit more than 2,000 adult patients fulfilled the criteria of severe sepsis, septic shock, and ICU admission within 24 hours from the emergency department. And they divided the patients in four categories according to body temperature. And just looking at the crude mortality, they found the same result as a previous study, clear message that in high temperature there's an association to low mortality. They also stratified the patients according to age, lactate levels, microbiology, and whether they completed the sepsis bundle. But in all cases, a little bit complicated pictures, but in all cases, there was the same signal that high temperatures was associated with a lower mortality. They asked the question, could this just be confounding, that higher temperature lead to more timely and better quality of care? And therefore, they made several multivariate models adjusted for quality of care and different covariates concerning severity of illness, but they ended up concluding that the fever mortality association remained firm. So in conclusion, patients with septic shock in the emergency department, but later admitted to ICU, the increased body temperature was strongly associated with lower mortality and a shorter hospital stay. So, it seems that there's pretty strong evidence that fever is associated with lower mortality in infected ICU patients. So that makes you speculate, why is it common therapy to treat fever in ICU patients with paracetamol or acetaminophen, as it's called in Australia and New Zealand? And I'm sure it happens every day also in your departments. And that question was asked again by this group from Australia and New Zealand in the HEAT trial, published in 2015. They hypothesized that treatment with paracetamol to treat fever in the ICU would actually worsen the outcome. And they randomized 700 patients with fever and known or suspected infection to either 1 gram of paracetamol or placebo every 6 hours until ICU discharge, resolution of fever, stop of antibiotics, or death. And then they looked at the number of ICU-free days from randomization to day 28. This is the temperature curve, and you may notice that the effect of paracetamol may be smaller than most doctors would actually expect. This is the primary and secondary endpoints, and there was absolutely no effect. This is the survival curve, no difference. So they ended up concluding that the early administration of acetaminophen or paracetamol to treat fever due to probable infection did not affect the number of ICU-free days and none of the mortality outcomes. So, and this is completely in line with this older study from 97 by Bernard and co-workers, where they did almost the same, but they used ibuprofen to reduce temperature in patients with sepsis and septic shock in almost 500 patients, and they found the same, no difference in mortality in the two groups. So what about external cooling? So this paper by Shorten and co-workers, they looked at the more severely sick patients with septic shock in the ICU, and they used external cooling to fever control. So it was a well-conducted, multi-center, randomized controlled trial, and they included febrile patients with septic shock requiring vasopressors, mechanical ventilation, and sedation. So it's the most sick patients we have. And they applied external cooling to achieve normothermia for 48 hours, or in the control group, fever respect and no external cooling. And then they adjusted vasopressors to maintain the same blood pressure target in the two groups. And the primary endpoint was the number of patients with a 50% decrease in baseline vasopressor dose after 48 hours. This is just the flow chart. They ended up randomizing 200 patients, 100 in each, or almost 100 in each group. This is a protocol for weaning vasopressors, and this is the result. In the group of cooled patients, they found a 50% reduction of vasopressor that was reached earlier in the cooled patients. But they also looked at the 14-day mortality that they found was significantly lower in the cooled patients. Conclusion was that fever control using external cooling in these patients with septic shock, first, it's safe, it decreases vasopressor requirements, and it decreases early mortality. So what about meta-analysis? Can we get any help here? And actually, recently this study has been published in Critical Care Medicine. It's a systematic review and meta-analysis. And they screened or found 1,100 papers and ended up including 8 randomized studies and 8 observational studies. And you may notice that some of them are those we have just been going through. But you may also see that the overall effect on antipyretic therapy is not very big. Actually, they found that there's no effect. Antipyretic therapy does not improve the 28-day mortality. And they also conclude that additional studies are unlikely to be powered to really change this conclusion. So, but you may see this is a different type of studies. There's the Shortgen study using external cooling, and there's the Young study using acetaminophen, and so on. So it's different kind of patients pooled into one. So that makes you, again, speculate. It seems that in infected ICU patients, antipyretic therapy, it's probably safe, but it's probably not beneficial in the overall group of infected patients. But again, we saw a signal in the most sick patients with septic shock, where external cooling to normal thermia may have a positive effect. So they went back and speculated and published this hypothesis. This is Shorten, who made the study by external cooling, and they said, well, then maybe we have to differentiate between the most sick infected patients and the least sick infected patients, and it may be that the cost of having fever is higher in the most sick patients compared to those with only minor infections. And therefore, we may see an effect of cooling in the most sick patients, and we may even do harm in the least sick patients. And when we look at the whole group together, we won't see anything. And this theory was also put up by the Australian group, by Paul Young and co-workers. Almost the same theory. If you look at the benefits of fever, they hypothesize that the benefits will probably be the same in both the least sick and the most sick patients, but the cost of fever may be high in the most sick patients. So it's the most sick patient where you maybe can see an effect of the cooling. So on basis of that, they have designed a protocol to test this, the reactor protocol, and we are waiting for the results of that. Okay, so what about mild induced hypothermia, target temperature management, or what you would call it, in septic shock? Is that a new idea? Actually not. This group published in JAMA in 61, a case series, 33 patients with severe septic shock, and they were cooled to 32 degrees, and they have actually found a lower expected mortality, and they hypothesized that the reduced mortality was due to decreased oxygen consumption and induced bradycardia and vasoconstriction. This is not controlled study, it was just case series, and they what they said was a lower mortality than the normally expected mortality. William Schumer in 62 published this, also a case series of 18 patients with severe peritonitis, and he ended up concluding that hypothermia is an adjuvant in septic shock and the use is strongly urged. So, just to say that this idea came up many years ago, but since then, nobody has really tested this in humans. However, a lot of animal studies have investigated different mechanisms in septic shock, and if this is the sort of overview of the mechanisms in septic shock, bacterial toxins causing release of TNF-alpha and other pro-inflammators, activation of the coagulation, tissue ischemia, apoptosis, microcirculation breakdown, and in the end you will end up having organ failure. A lot of animal studies, mostly in rats, but also in larger animals, has tested different many of these different mechanisms, and a lot of them actually come out with beneficial effects. It has been shown to reduce bacterial growth and toxin production, to inhibit TNF-alpha, inhibit platelet aggregation, leukocyte adhesion, and to act anticoagulatory. Also been shown that cooling would lower metabolism and reduce ischemia. Cooling can reduce iNOS expression and thereby act against endothelial damage. It can act against apoptosis. And animals had also shown that cooling can cause shorter organ failure and even improve survival. There will also be animal studies or rat studies pointing in the other direction. But it seems that that cooling, mild-induced hypothermia, acts on several mechanisms in the sepsis pathophysiology and the metabolism, coagulation, apoptosis, and toxin production. And on basis on that, we designed the CAS study, the cooling and surviving septic shock study, with the purpose of investigating whether mild-induced hypothermia improves survival in patients with septic shock. And we set out to investigate whether cooling to 32 to 34 degrees for 24 hours in these septic shock patients would improve survival, with the hypothesis that these effects would cause benefit for these patients. This is the flowchart. We aimed at 560 patients, randomized in two groups. One group would be cooled to 32 to 34 degrees for 24 hours, and the other group, there would be fever respect. They would be followed in 30 days, and 5 interim analyses was done. This is the participating hospitals, and this is the steering committee, and the recruitment curve. And the status of the study at this moment is that 432 patients are included. And just recently, the study has been stopped by the Data Safety Management Board due to futility. And the publication process is ongoing. So unfortunately, I have promised not to reveal detailed data on this study at this moment, but it will be published soon and presented. So my overall conclusions are that fever in infected patients in the ICU is associated with lower mortality and shorter hospital stays. And in infected ICU patients, antipyretic therapy seems to be safe, but it does not reduce mortality or length of stay. However, in septic shock, external cooling to normothermia may show improved hemodynamics and reduced early mortality. And with regard to induced hypothermia or TTM cooling, It has multiple effects in septic shock, and animal studies have in general showed improved organ function and improved survival. I've not talked much about this, but some pre-data from the CAS study show that coagulation seemed to be improved during cooling. But it still remains unclear whether it can improve the prognosis of septic shock. But the CAS study will bring clarity to this. Thank you.
Thank you so much for a very nice lecture. Let's see here if we do have any questions from the audience. For the CAS study, did you cool the patients externally or with an intravenous device?
Well, this it was up to the site to cool the patient the way they normally cool. So they would use the device they normally used to cool cardiac arrest patients. So it was, but in most of the sites they used external cooling. Only a few of the patients were internal cooling.
Okay. And should we interpret these results that hypothermia is dangerous, but that the inflammatory response associated with fever is dangerous?
May I have that again?
Yes. Should we interpret these results that hypothermia is dangerous, but that the inflammatory response associated with fever or should probably say or somewhere. Should we interpret that these results that hypothermia is dangerous or that the inflammatory response is associated with fever is dangerous? So either the hypothermia in itself or the inflammatory response. It's like the fever just a marker of the inflammatory response.
Okay. I think the results are pretty strong that the fever is associated with lower mortality. So, yeah, I'm not sure I can elaborate more on that. No.
I have a little bit of a detailed question, maybe because I have an interest in mitochondria myself, and with the regards to that, it's been shown in sepsis that certain subgroups of the so-called haplogroups in mitochondria are associated with a better survival and could be due to somehow with temperature and fever handling. Have you have any sub-study, do you do, or in your CAS study?
No, we don't have sub-studies on it, no. But I know there are rat studies looking into mitochondrial function and yeah. So, but this is a pragmatic clinical study, so no, we're not looking into that.
All right.
Okay.
Other questions from the floor? All right, thank you so much.